Hare Krishna. So I'm grateful to be here with all of you today. And so I'll speak today on the topic of, from the Ramayana, of crossing the COVID-19 ocean, lessons from Hanuman's journey. The Ramayana is a book that has few parallels in world history in terms of the number of people it has inspired and influenced. When the British came to India, at that time, they had their own agendas. Either it was to westernize India, it was to Christianize India. It was basically to make Indians subordinate to the West, whether it's Western religion or Western colonialism, Western capitalism, whatever. So after studying India for many decades, one prominent British thinker in India, he said that if you want to understand India, if you want to understand the Indian mind, you need to study the Ramayana. So the Ramayana, we are taking his statement over here to begin this talk, because the Ramayana has influenced the Indian mind in a way that few other books have influenced, not just the Indian mind, but have influenced the world anywhere. And one reason for its enduring influence is its relevance. So the Ramayana teaches us spiritual values, it teaches us human values. So today I'll talk about the parallels between Hanuman's enormously challenging journey to Lanka and how we are dealing today with this crisis of the COVID-19 ocean. So I'll use this, I have a PowerPoint, but this PowerPoint may also serve as a whiteboard where I may speak, write some points as we move forward. So the COVID crisis seems to be like an ocean now. We are even using the word waves for it. The first wave came and went and there was celebration. India seemed to be like a model for the world of dealing with COVID. The second wave has come and it is becoming quite acute. So when we are in the middle of the ocean seems so large as to appear unending. But it does end. There is land beyond the ocean. And we just need to persevere till we get to the land. So, in the Ramayana, while there is a whole devotional context, but the challenges that the characters face, the emotions that they go through, the decisions that they have to make, all these are remarkably similar to what we have to go through. The specific actions that they do, the specific forms that they have, there are demons with four heads and there are monkeys who can fly and all these things are there and they can be explained in appropriate ways. But rather than getting caught in those, we look at the overall principles that the challenges they face are similar to what we face. So let's look at it from that perspective. So we can strive to be like Hanuman. Today is Ram Navami. And the glory of God is manifested most fully through the glory of God as manifested in those devoted to Him. So the Lord doesn't desire His own glory. The Lord desires the glory of those who are devoted to Him. And thus, there are a few better ways to celebrate the appearance of Lord Ram than to celebrate the glorious activities of the greatest devotee of Ram, that is Hanuman, and to contemplate what he can teach us. So Hanuman was flying above this ocean, and in that ocean, there were dangerous predatory beings, there were huge stormy waves above him, the overhead, the sun was beating heavily on him, and yet he kept flying. So for all of us, the world is like an ocean. Now, right now, there's the biggest danger of physical infection. But it's not just physical infection. There is, along with it, mental dysfunction. I've been a part of several conferences and seminars in America on mental health and spirituality. And I'm in touch with professionals over there, as well as pioneers on mental health and spirituality. So they've been telling me that the number of people facing mental health problems in today's world are huge. We are so concerned about the epidemic, pandemic at the physical level, but the disruption that it has caused in people's life financially, also not just financially, existentially. Existentially means we all have a vision of what my life is meant to be, how I'm meant to live, what life is meant for. So that can also get disoriented. What brings meaning to my life? So all these oceans, waves are there in it. And we want to rise above and we want to move above them. So let's see what we can learn from Hanuman about how we can rise and persevere above the ocean of distresses and dangers that surround us in the world today. So we look at four virtues that Hanuman manifests during his journey to Lanka. He's tireless, resourceful, fearless, and forceful. Let's look at them one by one. So, tireless. Before we look at the virtues, we human beings are inherently purpose-driven creatures. So, Hanuman had a mission. So, this depicts the success of his mission. And while he was moving, he was envisioning the success vision that he will meet Sita and he will talk with her and then he will go back to Ram and report that. So Hanuman's mission was to be an instrument of Ram. So it is described in the Nam Ramayana that how did the Vanaras progress? That they were progressed by remembering that they were working for Ram's on Ram's behalf. So Ram had given him an instruction to locate Sita. And when he was going to locate Sita, it was not just to locate Sita. He was going to reassure Sita that Ram is going to come. He is going to rescue you. He is going to deliver you. So he had that mission. And we humans are inherently purpose-driven creatures. Now, if we don't have a purpose, if we don't have a direction, then we become overwhelmed by negativity. So what could be our mission? Now, in this time, each of us, we have certain abilities, certain resources. Yes, of course, we have limitations, we have challenges. But wherever we are, we can become an instrument of divine compassion for helping each other and especially for helping those who are trapped in misery. Just as Sita was trapped in misery, bound, imprisoned by Ravan in Lanka. So different people are in different levels of distress. Now we may say, who am I to help others? I'm not a medical professional. I can't treat people. Okay, that's fine. But the needs of people are not just medical. Medical is one aspect of it. There is so many ways in which if a heart wants to help, many are the ways that the hand can find to help. And what happens when we have a mission? What is important to have? Why is it important to have a sense of purpose, have a sense of mission? Because otherwise, what happens is we start sinking into ourselves. Without a mission, without a purpose, we drown in the ocean of self-pity. Oh, this problem in my life and that problem in my life and that problem in my life. And so many things are going wrong in my life. And that's how we make our life miserable. Instead of being a part of the solution, we become part of the problem. And paradoxically, if we strive to be a part of the solution, we find that our own problems also start decreasing. So when we say be an instrument of divine compassion, what does it mean? That we all have certain power. We all have certain intelligence. We all have certain abilities. But our intelligence, our ability, if we do whatever we can in a mood of service, in a mood of devotion, then as God helps those who help themselves. If we try to do what we can in a mood of service, we'll find that powers greater than ourselves will come to our aid. And we will be able to do far more than what we can do. So let's look at this theme of an instrument of divine compassion a little later. If this all this sounds a little lofty, we could just think of it in simple terms, you know. Wherever I am, can I make things better instead of worse? You know, we may say, I am so powerless, what can I do? I am so tiny, I am so insignificant. Yes, that is true. We are insignificant. Now, who am I to be an instrument of divine compassion or anything like that? So I'll raise one significant point over here. That so we sometimes feel powerless. Maybe sometimes we feel, are we too tiny to make a difference? Whether it is, now of course, we are tiny, we are very small, the world is very big, but we can make a difference. How can we know that? Let's look at it from another way. Now, when things may be very bad, we feel that things are so bad, what can I do about it? So we may feel, what can I do? So we can ask this question to ourselves, can I make things worse? Now we may say, what kind of question is that? Who would want to make things worse? Things are terrible. Yeah, nobody wants to make things worse, but can we make things worse? You know, this is, no matter how bad things are, we never lose the power to make them worse. We never lose the power to make them worse. You know, we may have a terrible, one of our important relationships may be going downhill. And we may say, what can I do about it? I can't do anything yet. Well, just remove all verbal restraint for 10 minutes. A relationship we may have cultivated for 10 years can completely get devastated in 10 minutes. So, no matter how bad things are, we never lose the power to make them worse. And if we can make things worse, we can make them better too. If we have the power to make a difference, we can make a difference in the negative direction or we can make a difference in the positive direction. Now, how much difference can we make? That depends on our vision, our intention, our motivation. But we can make a difference. So the world may be in a big crisis right now, but each of us can make a difference. Now, our efforts may be, there is so much darkness around us, our effort may be like a tiny flashlight. But even the tiniest of flashlight can provide light. It can provide light to us. It can provide light to people around us. So that will be our attitude in this discussion, how we can make a difference. And we all can make a difference. So while Hanuman was crossing over the ocean to go toward Lanka, he at that time encountered suddenly in his path a mountain rising. And that mountain was personified as Mainak. And he said that actually, you know, I am related to you in various ways. I won't go into the elaborates of the story, but he said, you are going on an extremely difficult mission and you've been traveling for so long. Hanuman had been flying across the ocean, leaping across the ocean, whatever word we want to use. He said, rest on me for some time. But Hanuman, he nodded. He said, thank you for the offer. And he politely touched the mountaintop. And then he moved on. He said, I have an urgent mission. I have an urgent mission. He took a rain check. He said, later, maybe sometime in future. So what does it mean? Hanuman was focused on his mission. He didn't let lethargy or tiredness come in the way. He said, we may have opportunities for personal comfort right now. But we as human beings have much to do to help each other amid this massive crisis. Now, if we start thinking about personal comfort, we may think, oh, I'm not getting, I can't go out for a walk, I can't do this, I can't do that. There's so many things I can't do. But if you think, how can I help? So if we place our shared cause above personal comfort, during this time, I have found that sharing the spiritual wisdom of the Gita can give so much solace and strength to so many people. So that's what we are trying to do. And there are many ways, according to our particular situation, our particular position, that we can help others. Actually, the more we, if our focus becomes seeking comfort, and the problem is no amount of comfort is ever enough. And then we will always feel come like complaining, I don't have this, and I don't have that, and I don't have that, and I don't have that. So I was just talking with a acquaintance in America, and he said, I'm so miserable. He said, I'm in the hospital. I'm down with COVID. I'm in a hospital. And my hospital doesn't have AC. It is so hot over here. And I told him that, you know, here in hospitals in India, people are lying in the corridors. They don't have oxygen, and somehow they're surviving. I was shocked when he heard this. It's just a matter of perspective. You know, when we seek comfort, there is no limit to how much comfort we want. And we can keep complaining. But rather than comfort, seeking comfort for ourselves, we shift to how can I offer help to others? And we focus on that, we can be tireless in moving ahead. Then as Hanuman moved on, the next challenge he encountered was Surasa. The Surasa, she appeared like a demoness, and she was huge. And she said, I have been given a benediction by the devtas, by Brahma, that whoever passes this way will enter into my mouth. Now, Hanuman, what he did was, he said, okay, but I am too big to enter into your mouth. And he started becoming bigger and bigger. And then she made her mouth bigger, and he made his size bigger, and she made her mouth bigger, and he made his size bigger, and she made her mouth bigger. And suddenly, Hanuman decreases size, he became tiny, entered into her mouth, and came out of it. And Surasa was pleased. He says, see, he also folded his hands and offered respects to her. He said, you know, now the word that you had, the what you wanted that I entered into your mouth, I have done that. Please let me go ahead in my service to Ram. So Surasa smiled and she said, yes. Actually, she revealed, I am not a demoness. I am a goddess. I was sent by the devtas to test you. You will face many more obstacles when you go to Lanka. And you wanted to see how resourceful you are. You are indeed a worthy servant of Ram, and may all success come upon you. When dealing with conflicts, we need to be resourceful. What does resourcefulness mean? That means if we focus on fulfilling our purpose. That doesn't necessarily mean that we have to every obstacle has to be defeated. It can just be bypassed. So we can think out of the box. Okay, if I can't deal with it this way, can I deal with it that way? If I can't deal with it this way, can we do this? So sometimes we have our mind runs on one track. This is the problem and this is the solution. And this solution is not working. What can I do about it? Oh, there's nothing we can do about it. No, we think about out of the box. So we, at one level, the COVID crisis has revealed the fragility of humanity. Now, one tiny being, which is so tiny that it is invisible even to the bacteria that are invisible to us. So viruses are so tiny that even bacteria can't see them, and we can't see bacteria. So such a tiny being has brought the whole world to a standstill, so to speak. We're somehow recovering from it. So in one sense, the COVID crisis has revealed our fragility. But in other sense, it has also revealed our resilience, the human capacity to spring back from difficulties. Physically, we can't have talks like this. We are having digital talks. People can't commute to office. We are working from homes. So the human spirit is incredibly resilient. And to the extent we don't let our thoughts, our ideas, our imagination be limited by our situation, we will be able to find a way ahead. So we need to think out of the box. And that's why when we face problems or obstacles, especially obstacles that are coming from someone. So Hanuman could have said, oh, you know, I will defeat you, I will destroy you. So when there are conflicts, what I want and what you want, they can be two opposite things. And you say, either I have to win or you have to win. What do we do? But are they really opposite? Are there ways in which both wants can be met? If they can be met, then there can be a win-win solution. So Hanuman was creative enough. He wanted to go to Lanka to serve Lord, to fulfill Lord Ram's instructions. And Sursa wanted that whoever passed by went through her mouth. So he did that. He did that in a resourceful way. So to be resourceful, what does it mean? That means to not have only one resource. This is the only way I'm going to do things. To be resourceful, to be full of resources. If things can't work this way, let's try this way. If things can't work this way, let's try that way. And this human capacity for resilience, that is what raises us above the nature of the world, which is filled with distress and ultimately death. This resilience ultimately points to transcendence. There is a part of us which goes beyond matter. We'll talk about it in the next part. That, why do we humans spring back again and again? No matter how many difficulties are there. Yes, sometimes people get crushed. No, sometimes we ask, you know, why do people become depressed? Why do people become mad with anger? Why do people commit suicide? But actually, the question we should be asking is opposite. You know, why do so many people not commit suicide? Why are most people not mad with anger? Why are most people not depressed? Life is tough. It's incredibly tough. And why are not more people depressed, suicidal, or maniac? That's because within our core, within us at our core, is a spark of the divine that is inextinguishable, that is indestructible, that can spring forth from the greatest of difficulties. So, in one sense, if we live with a materialistic view of life, then we are limiting our vision to one track. But if we get a spiritual vision of life, we see life has many tracks. Okay, things don't move in this track. It can move in this track. They can move in this track. So one way of becoming resourceful is to expand our vision of life, to understand that there are many ways to progress in our life. And once we have an expanded vision, we can choose our battles. Choose our battles means that we need to put small differences and ego issues aside to be of service to each other. Sometimes I want to do it this way, you want to do it this way. Now, some people are just by nature irritable. So for them, the laws of physics apply in a different way. For them, to every action, there is an exaggerated and irritating reaction. Now, for everything that happens, they will complain about this and that and that and that. They'll complain about us, they'll complain about others, they'll complain about the weather, they'll complain about the world. We might just get irritated. We might just get annoyed with it, exasperated. Well, if that is the way they are, that is the way they are. We can't change it. But we don't have to become the way they are. Just let their words, they come in through one ear, go through another ear. We don't have to persuade them. We don't have to listen to them. We can just move on in our life. So sometimes some people just need to vent. Let them vent and move on. So choose your battles. Being resourceful means choosing our battles. Not every battle needs to be won through a direct confrontation. Sometimes some battles can be just bypassed and we move ahead. So the history of human, if you can see the history of human society, is a history of challenges and meeting challenges. Then another challenge, we meet another challenge. And this will go on. But through it all, if our wisdom evolves, if our spirituality evolves, then there is lasting benefit for us and there is lasting benefit for others. So then Hanuman met a third demoness, that was Simhika. Third obstacle, rather. She was actually the first demoness. Surasa, I said, well, she was not demoness. So Simhika, as Hanuman was flying above, suddenly he felt himself immobilized. And he was just not able to move. And he looked up and he saw, he couldn't see anything. He looked around, he didn't see anything. He looked down and he saw this demoness. She was looking up at him with jeering expression on her eyes, you know, licking her tongue. So she had some mystic powers. So she was physically far away, but from there she could just immobilize him completely. She just left him immobilized. So when she was like that, and when I had visited Princeton for speaking, I was taken by the organizers to a lab, former lab there, that where they were studying paranormal phenomena. So, for example, PSI, extraterrestrial perception, extrasensory perception, telepathy, and other psychokinesis. And it's remarkable the amount of evidence that they had accumulated about these issues. So, of course, that's a different subject. But the idea of Simhika just from distance controlling Hanuman, it may seem remarkable for us, but it's a form of psychokinesis or psychostasis, you can say. From distance, exerting influence and causing motion. She stopped Hanuman from moving and then she started pulling Hanuman down. And Hanuman just couldn't do anything. But what did he do? He just couldn't do anything. And he just watched as some force beyond him just drew him down, and then he was swallowed. But he didn't lose heart. He broke through her belly and came out victorious. So we need to be fearless and watchful. Fearless means sometimes we will be temporarily rendered powerless. Sometimes situations come in such a way that we can only watch. We're just being almost ingested into the situation. We just can't do anything. We decide, I don't want to do this. I don't want to get involved in this. But we seem to be dragged into it. So at that time, rather than getting panicky, rather than getting fearful, yes, sometimes it's just that things don't work our way. But that doesn't mean they will never work our way. So we be patient. Wait, we can avoid becoming fearful and we can wait for the opportunity to come. And for us, opportunity will come. In the world, there are phases. Sometimes happiness, sometimes distress. Sukhe dukhe same krutva. Krishna says, be equipoised among all. Now, in Bollywood, there was a movie, Kabhi Khushi Kabhi Gam. So the idea is, yes, happiness and distress will be there. Neither will be constantly with us. But our purpose can be constantly with us. And if our purpose itself is only happiness, is gaining happiness or avoiding distress, then we will feel, if we don't get happiness or we get distress, our purpose is being thwarted. But we are meant for a higher purpose in life. Our purpose is to manifest our potential, to do good in the world, and ultimately evolve in consciousness toward the divine. So when we have a higher purpose in life, then we don't let situations overwhelm us. So sometimes we feel trapped. It may, just like Simhika was, had immobilized and she was ingesting Hanuman. Sometimes we may feel like that. That's what's happening to us. We may sometimes face failure. But failure is one event in life. It is never life's defining event. Everybody faces failure, but it is what spirituality does is, it doesn't remove failure from our life, but it redefines our relationship with failure. This is an important concept. What is my relationship with failure? Now we said, what do you mean by relationship with failure? When we have a relationship with someone, so if we have a very, very bad relationship with someone, then what happens? As soon as that person comes, we start feeling annoyed, we start feeling nervous, we start feeling angry. So that means that relationship creates certain emotions within us. So what is our relationship with failure? If I think, oh, failure is so terrible, failure is a disaster. So then what happens is, as soon as failure comes, that is the relationship that we have, corresponding emotions come upon us, and then we get overwhelmed. But if you understand, yes, failure is a part of life. Failure is not the whole of life. Life is not like a 100-meter sprint. It is like a 100-mile marathon. And even if you fall back in one phase of life, it doesn't matter. Hanuman failed in trying to avoid or to break free from Simhika's grip. But he didn't become disheartened. So right now we may feel that the COVID situation is such that sometimes we may even physically fall sick, our loved ones may physically fall sick, sometimes we have financial difficulties. We feel that the situation is just leaving us helpless. It's just drawing us inside. We may feel, I mean, consumed by it. But don't lose hope. Don't lose hope. Be patient. Be perseverant. No, expanding our vision of life, that's what spirituality does. As I said, that life is not a 100-meter sprint. It is a 100-mile marathon. And when I talk about a 100-mile marathon, that actually extends beyond this life. It is, we are, what the spiritual traditions of the world say is that this life is not our only life. The Bhakti tradition, the Gita tradition, it explains it further that we are non-material beings and we are on a multi-life journey of spiritual evolution. And that's why even what might seem the ultimate failure, death, that is also not the end. Death is just a comma. It's not a full stop. We continue to exist beyond death. I have written a book, Demystifying Reincarnation, where given dozens of cases of children who remember past lives, cases that have been very rigorously investigated by top-notch researchers. So that is one evidence indicative of this expanded vision of life. What it does for us is we start seeing if even the ultimate terrible event is just death, if that is not a full stop, then why should I let the events of this life, I lost a job, or my health went down, or this happened, or this thing. Why should I let those events get to me so much? Yes, sometimes events may suck me in, but I can break free. I just need to be patient. I need to be watchful. So we need to wait our time. Then the last obstacle that Hanuman faced as he flew across the ocean and eventually came to Lanka, he wanted to sneak in. But then he found there was this powerful and fearsome demoness who was blocking his way. But again, Hanuman didn't give in to fear. He pressed on. What did she try to attack him? But Hanuman just hit one light slap at her. Now, she was so surprised, first of all, that this tiny monkey is attacking me. And secondly, such was the force. Now, he didn't attack her so powerfully as to wound her or kill her. But he hit her sufficiently that she fell off the way, and then he went ahead. So here, sometimes we have to use force. The force he used was not to destroy, but force was to remove the obstacle from his way. Life is such that we can't just wait for things to happen. If we want things to happen, we have to make them happen. If we compare it, life, the world to be like a hotel, it's not a hotel where somebody will come, a waiter or waitress will come to us and ask us what we want. Like a self-serving restaurant. We have to go, okay, these are all the items over here. What do you want? You take a little from here, take a little from here, take a little, and make your own menu. So sometimes we have to exert force. We have to throw our weight around. It is. Now, one of my friends is in Europe, and some parts of Europe are aggressively atheistic. Others are okay. So he was offering spiritual counseling. So he offers counseling. He's certified in psychology, but he's also offering, he brings spiritual insights into his counseling. So now often people have concerns that secular concerns, they're valid concerns, but that people shouldn't use somebody's distress to convert someone. That is a valid concern, but ultimately the point is not converting, the point is assisting. So he, there were so many people during this COVID time who were like in severe distress. But he was told, he's following the Gita spirituality. And he said, you can't help these people because you are from a different religion. He said, I'm only offering wisdom. I'm not trying to convert anyone over here. So he says, no, you can't do it. And he told them that, there are people in distress, they are in trauma, they're emotionally broken down. One of the things that modern medical science has found is that if people are emotionally broken, then their body also breaks down much faster. There's a provocative paper in the journal Science that where science and spirituality kiss each other. What it meant was that if a person is terribly sick with a disease like cancer or something, then if they have some they have people around them who love them, especially if they have a loving spouse, a loving partner. Then people who have that loving support, so you have a control group and a test group. So both of them have similar kind of cancer, similar prognosis. But those who have a loving support group, they get healed faster. So he said that, let me just go there. If they object, if they complain, you can send me away. Even if one person complains, you don't let me enter anywhere. But you know how much it is that if people don't get emotional support, how they break down. So he had to push his weight around. So they finally they allowed him. And then he went and he talked about spiritual wisdom. He gave them strength. He gave them solace. He gave them guidance. He taught them some breathing exercises, some meditation. And he was respectful of their faiths. And he offered them help. See, most people are in today's world are nominally religious. They're not like very deeply religious. So ultimately, why does a person, any person anywhere turn toward religion? They turn toward it because they want some, you could say, resources to face life's challenges. So in this humanitarian crisis, he offered some resources and he was of immense help. And then there's, he has been doing this for several months now. And not only that hospital, he was invited to go to other hospitals, and the city over there, they gave him a certification. Thank you for your sterling service in this time of crisis. Sometimes, even when we want to do good things, we have to push. We have to sometimes throw our weight around. Just because somebody is obstructing doesn't mean, oh, what can I do? You stop me. If we're doing good, we have to sometimes use force. So sometimes we are afraid of people, and sometimes we are afraid of using force with people. By force, I don't mean physical force or violence. I don't mean being abusive. But what I mean is that just don't let others rule over us. So any problem, whether it is a situation or it is a person, they grow threatening the more we let them prey on our mind. Oh, you know, this person stopped me. This person doesn't let me do this. And we start feeling sorry for ourselves. We start letting the problem grow bigger and bigger. And then it preys on our mind. Our mind becomes like a prey. It becomes like a predator. And it devours our mind. So we may say that to use force properly, I need to be free from fear. Well, we can't exactly be free from fear. That's why I said fearless. It is not so easy to be fearless. Fearless means, it means fear becomes less. Less than what? Less than our purpose. To be fearless, we don't need absence from fear. Absence of fear. We need a purpose bigger than fear. Because he wanted to help people, so he was able to overcome that fear. Hanuman was alone going into Lanka. Alone, single-handedly. It was enemy territory filled with powerful demons. But his purpose was bigger than his fear. So for each one of us, if we strive for fearlessness in this way, we all can move ahead. And whatever challenges we may face, we can overcome them. So now, of course, when you talk about fearless, being fearless doesn't mean being reckless. Hanuman, although he had overcome Lanka, he kept an inconspicuous form. So just because we want to help others doesn't mean that we avoid basic precautions that are required for avoiding infections. So many of my friends are in the medical care field, and they are careful, but they are careful. They're not careless, but they're not fearful. So they go and offer service. So, but at the same time, they're cautious not to get infection. So Hanuman didn't, I have overcome this obstacle. Who can challenge me? Who can obstruct me? He didn't court trouble. If trouble came, he didn't let the trouble stop him, but he didn't go about inviting trouble by taking on a big form. So be cautious, but don't let fear rule your life. If fear rules our life, we will make our life miserable. As it is said, a coward dies 1,000 deaths before the actual death. So ultimately, we talked about these 4 virtues of Hanuman. His most defining virtue, however, was his faith. His faithfulness. Hanuman, as he was leaping across Lanka, going through the sky, he was constantly chanting the names of Ram. Jai Shri Ram, Jai Shri Ram, Ram Ram. So he was chanting the names of Ram in this way. And he was chanting them. That enabled him to cross over the ocean. The faith is a remarkable power that each of us can have. And if we can tap the power of faith, some people think of faith as a sign of lacking critical intelligence, a sign of blind belief. It's not like that. Everyone has faith. It is just what we have faith in. When I was invited to Cambridge University to speak on science and spirituality, I passed by the tree where Newton is said to have seen the fruit falling, the apple. Some people say it fell on his head. Some people say it fell in front of him. Either way, when that apple fell, what happened? Most of us, if an apple fell in front of us, we would just pick it up and eat it. Newton could have done that. We didn't do that. Thought, what made this apple fall? Now, when he asked this question, he had the faith that apples don't fall just by chance, that there is a pattern to nature, that the nature has an order, and it is that order that I can uncover. So science and faith are not opposites, because science itself is grounded in faith. Science is grounded in the faith that nature has some order. And that we, by observing with our senses and by analyzing with our mind, can discern that order. So faith is required in any area of life if you want to make progress. But what matters is, what do we have faith in? So spirituality reveals to us the ultimate object that we can have faith in, the ultimate empowerment that we can get through having to directing our faith in that direction. So the vision of faith is that God has not brought us so far to abandon us. What do we mean brought us so far? If we look at our lives, now all of you will be of different ages. Some may be 20, some 25, some 30, 35, 40. There are millions of people who die before they come to our age. If we look at our own lives, so many things could have gone wrong. We may have worked hard to come where we have come. But along with our hard work, there are so many things which fell in the right place. Who did that? We didn't do it. It was ultimately something beyond us that did it. That something beyond, when understood properly, is the ultimate reality, is God. So our very existence is based on forces far beyond us. So it is God who has brought us so far, not to abandon us. He will see us through. He will take us all the way. So when we remember God, we get these three things. So faith is not just, oh, God exists somewhere. Faith is expressed through devotional remembrance of God. So what we are doing in Ram Navami today is remembering the Lord. So when we do this by here, now remembering is not just say chanting his holy names or going to a temple and doing some singing or some worship. Remembering can be done also by understanding the message of the Lord, understanding the wisdom that he has shared. So three things will happen by this: comfort, clarity, and confidence. When we remember God, then what happens is we understand that no matter how bad things are, there is a higher plan. There is a purpose for what things are. Purpose behind whatever is happening. That gives us some comfort. That gives us some solace. And then once we understand, yes, there is a purpose behind all that is happening, but then there is something I can do within it. There is a role I can play. When we understand that, we get clarity. And then, okay, as we start doing something positive in a mood of service, in a mood of devotion, then we start getting confidence. So Hanuman embodies extraordinary confidence as he flew across the ocean to enter into Lanka and eventually emerge victorious. The book in which Hanuman's heroics are described is Sundar Kand, which is one of the most beloved sections of the Ramayana. And the Sundar Kand is actually very similar to how God exists, to how the nature of the world is. In the Sundarkand, Ram is almost absent. Hanuman is dispatched, and Hanuman goes through various adventures. He finds Sita. He gives a stern warning and a strong message, and a strong demonstrative message to Lanka, to the Lanka's citizens and Lanka's monarch, by setting it on fire. And then he returns victorious to meet Ram. So overall, in the Sundarkand, the Lord is not present, except in the hearts of his devotees, in the heart of Hanuman primarily. So similarly, in this world, we can't see the presence of God. He's there, but he is hidden in our hearts. But just because he's hidden in our heart doesn't mean that he's absent or he's important. He's there with us to help us. So if we strive in a mood following that of Hanuman to try to do something good, then we will find that we will all be empowered to make a difference. Some of us may empower to make far greater difference than others, but that doesn't matter. At the very least, by just trying to act in a mood of service with spiritual wisdom, with spiritual direction, we will make our heart brighter. We will make our corner of the world brighter. And who knows, the light that comes from us can make more than our small corner of the world brighter also. So that is the enduring message of the Ramayana. Lord Ram descends to this world. He descended on Ram Navami thousands of years ago. But that is not just a historical event. That is an event that can be replicated in our heart. If we invoke our devotion, evoke devotion, if he descends in our heart, he lights our heart, and through us, he lights our world. It is for us to let him do that by opening our heart to his wisdom and his compassion for manifesting in our life and in our world. So I'll summarize what I spoke today. I spoke broadly on the theme of learning from Hanuman's example, crossing the COVID ocean. So just as Hanuman had a mission that was to be an instrument of Ram, similarly, we all need a mission. If we don't have purpose, then we sink into the ocean of self-pity, feeling sorry for all the things that are wrong in our life. But if we try to fix something in life, not just in our life, but in the world around us, we take responsibility, we find that our problems start becoming smaller and we start gaining a sense of power and purpose more and more. So Hanuman's virtues, we discussed four virtues. First was his tirelessness. He didn't accept the comforts of Menaka, but he didn't reject also. He politely took a rain check. So similarly, we might be in a comfortable situation right now, but there is so much that humanity needs today and we can do. So rather than if we start obsessing over our comforts or lack of comforts, there is no end to it. But if we focus on trying to be of service, we'll find that there's so much we can do, each one of us. So we may feel, what difference can I make? Well, can we make things worse? Yes, we all can make things worse. Then we have the power to make a difference. Then let's make a positive difference. Let's try to make things better. So then the second virtue I talked about is resourcefulness. When Simhika blocked him, he just entered into her mouth and came out. So rather than thinking it has to be win-lose, either I win and you lose or you win and I lose, we can think out of the box. We don't have to defeat every obstacle. How can I just persevere in my purpose? If we focus on the purpose, we will find ways to move ahead no matter what situations come in, obstruct us. So talking about how the COVID-19 has demonstrated the resilience of the human spirit, that despite so many problems at a global, social, economic level, human society is going on because there is a spark within us, spark of the divine, that is transcendental, that is never limited by anything material. And the more we manifest that, the more we become resilient. And the third I talked about was how Hanuman's encounter with, first was, sorry, second, first was Surasa, third was Simhika, With Simika, he remained fearless. Although he was swallowed by her, but he emerged. So sometimes situations may leave us helpless and they may just entangle us. But rather than losing hope or giving into fear, we wait. And opportunity will come. Failure is not life's defining event. It is just an event. And to expand our vision, I only talk about resourcefulness means we see life has multiple tracks, not just physical, not just material, but also spiritual. So similarly, if we consider fearlessness, if we understand that life is, in life, death is not the full stop. It is just a comma. We are on a multi-life journey. And if death itself is not the end, then why should we consider some problems in our life to be the end? Persevere. And we will find that opportunities will come for us. Then talked about Lankini's encounter. Hanuman was forceful. He didn't let fear of the opponent or fear of even using his force stop him. We don't want to be indiscriminately forceful and we don't want to be reckless. Hanuman didn't just barge in a giant form. He remained inconspicuous. But the principle is that we may even while doing good, sometimes we have to use force. The world is not going to give things to us on a platter. It's not like a restaurant with waiters. It is like a self-serve restaurant. So if we persist in a worthy cause with a requisite force, then we will find that we all can do more things than what we thought we could. We can do more good in the world. Ultimately, our purpose is to manifest our potential and to do good in the world in a mood of service to the Lord. So, and for all this, being faithful. Faithful was Hanuman's defining virtue. And that enabled him to cross over the ocean and do the wonderful things that he did. So for us, faith is not just like a religious dogma or some blind belief. It is an understanding that there is an order behind the apparent disorder of the world. And that is the basis of even science. When Newton saw the fruit falling, it was a random disorderly event. He saw the order. And that's how he came up with the discovery of gravity. So for all of us, faith means to understand that there is order behind the disorder of the world, apparent seeming disorder of the world. So with faith, we will understand that actually it is God who has brought us this far. There's so many things could have gone wrong in our life. But if he has brought us this far, he will take us all the way ahead. By remembering God, we can have comfort, we can have clarity, we can have confidence. And if we let God manifest in our heart through our devotion, then he will light our heart and through us, he will light our corner of the world. Inviting us to do that is the purpose of celebrating festivals like Ram Navami. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Are there any questions or comments?
The participants can ask questions or put their comments. Now it's open to them. I'll just open the audio part also. You can unmute yourself and ask question. Yes. Anybody has any question here?
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Dandavat.
Dandavat.
Prabhu, just one doubt. One follows some path which he thinks that it is the path which is meant for him or her. But after a long time also, that kind of success which is expected is not coming. Or, the average success is coming. So how to, keep oneself, how to take this signal of God? So it is like God is saying, maybe something else is meant for you and you are walking on the wrong path or... How to take that message from the God? If it happens at a considerable long time in somebody's life.
Yes. So this is an important question. If despite our best efforts for a long time, we are only getting moderate success, how do we take that? I would say we have to look at three things, broadly speaking. Our nature, our endeavor, and our culture. Our culture means our situation. Our nature, see, we all have a particular nature. Now, sometimes people nowadays say that, you know, you can achieve whatever you want in life, whatever you desire, you can achieve. Well, that is an exaggeration. Now, we are all naturally drawn towards certain things. We need to find out what it is that we are drawn to, what it is we are gifted in, what is it that we are interested in. And then try to do our best in that field. Not everybody can become a champion cricketer. Not everybody can become a great musician. Not everybody can become a lawyer or a doctor or an engineer, especially great in that field. So rather than thinking that I can achieve anything that I want, and if I can't achieve it, that's a failure for me, we try to look within. What are my natural gifts? What are my natural interests? See, we can't really choose our interests much. Our interests choose us. What does that mean? That we are naturally attracted, naturally drawn towards certain things. So, in one sense, you could use the metaphor of farming. When we are farming, we can't make any kind of crop grow on any kind of land. We have to understand the land. Okay, what kind of land do I have? Can I grow? Will rice grow over here? I might see my friend over there is growing mangoes. But that land might be different. And my land might be different. So I have to understand myself. So what are my natural interests? What are my natural talents? So this is called a kshetra in the Bhagavad Gita. So understand our kshetra. So look back at our lives and to understand what our nature is, what our natural gifts are, what our natural interests are, we can ask ourselves two questions. Now, what do I feel comfortable doing? And what am I competent at doing? Guna and karma, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita. So understand, look at our own nature. Then second is, of course, look at the endeavor. So going back to the farming agriculture metaphor, if it happens that yield is not coming on the ground, so it could be because the seeds you have sown are just not suited for that ground. Second could be that maybe you didn't, we didn't farm properly. Maybe we didn't know how to plow properly. Maybe we didn't plow adequately. Maybe we did things wrong. So we have to look at our endeavors, no doubt. Without that, we will not improve. And we all have room to improve. And thirdly, we have to look at the culture. By culture means, what is the social situation in the world around us? So the land may be right for growing particular things. But if there's no rain over there, or if the weather has become too hot, now because of climate change, there are changes in some parts of the world where things which were growing earlier in that part of the world are no longer growing. So sometimes, despite our best endeavors, the situations may be such that things just don't work. So we look at our nature, we look at our endeavor, and we look at our, we could say the culture around us or the world around us, broadly speaking. And then we come to a mature assessment. Sometimes it's good to write things down. So if we are going to make a major life-changing decision, we can't very well think in our head. I also do some seminars on journaling, how to journal for self-understanding, for self-transformation. So when we get thoughts out of our head and onto paper or onto a screen, then that distance between us and those thoughts gives us a greater clarity, better perspective. So we write down things and then we revisit them regularly every week or every at a periodic frequency. And over a period of time, greater clarity will evolve. So if it is that we are not working according to our nature, then maybe we need to do some change. And that voice, that guidance may come from outside, that guidance may just come as a voice from inside. And if we add to all this, especially the mood of prayer, then, I want to do what you want me to do, O Lord. Please guide me. So then if we have that prayerful mood of seeking guidance, we will get guidance. So whether it is the nature, we are doing something disharmonious with our nature, that does it mean we can change immediately? Do we change gradually? Or do we do something by the side which is according to our nature while continuing to do what we are doing? as our main activity, we look at those things and we make a decision. Do we need to spend more time trying to improve our endeavor? Or is it just that this particular setting is not suited? We look at Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada is one of the most prominent spiritual teachers from India in the 20th century. So he, for 60 years, at the age of almost 60, 70, he went to America. And in the last 10 years, he had phenomenal success in his spiritual outreach and sharing the wisdom of the Bhagavad Gita. So before that also, he was trying for 40 years. He was trying in India from 1922 to almost 1966. So he was trying, but it didn't work. Then he eventually realized that India in the immediate pre-independence time and the post-independence times was too politically obsessed to really value its own spirituality. So he decided that let me go to the West. And he reached with the West at a time when the West was very receptive spiritually. And he had phenomenal success, and there he came back. And then he was successful in India also, because Indians were politically obsessed, but they were also, it was like cultural nationalism for them. Oh, foreigners are practicing our culture. Maybe there's something in our culture. We want to learn about it. We want to promote it. So in his case, he was trying his best. It was his calling to share spiritual wisdom, but he realized that the situation is different. The situation is not conducive. So he changed the situation. He went to a different place. But there are other times when he was writing books and he kept writing. And then eventually the principle is sometimes our endeavor needs to improve. Sometimes we need to harmonize with our nature. And sometimes we need to change our external situations. So that we have to contemplate carefully and seek prayerful guidance. Then we will learn. Okay?
Hare Krishna. Krishna Prabhuji, Tushar has one question. So he's from COEP earlier, and Chetan Charan Prabhuji his room for conducting Gita class almost like 25 years back, I believe. So yes. It's a reunion after 25 years.
Happy to meet you. How are you doing?
I'm good.
You are based in Pune only now?
Yeah, in Pune only.
Excellent. Good to see you after a long time.
You remember him, Prabhuji?
We used to come to Sea Building.
Can you just expand your photo? Yes, please. I'm happy to see you. Yeah. Yes.
We used to come to Sea Building for the classes.
Yes, yes. I remember that. Yes, please tell me.
You were mentioning about having a faith in the purpose and Lord. But how is it different? Faith and devotion are different or they're same?
Okay, good question. Are faith and devotion same or different? They are very much related. In Sanskrit, the words are Shraddha and Bhakti. Okay. Or Nishtha, you can say. And you can also talk about Shraddha when deepened becomes Nishtha. Bhakti when deepened becomes Prema. Bhakti Prema. So there are stages, you could say. But broadly speaking, you could say that devotion is more of a emotion, whereas faith is more of a conviction. That means devotion means that, say, when we remember the Lord or when we behold His form in the temple, when we hear about His stories, we feel a sense of emotional attraction towards Him. We feel a sense of joy coming up within us. So that is devotion. Whereas faith is more, yes, there faith can also lead to devotion and devotion can also nourish faith. But faith is more a sense of clarity or certainty or conviction that this is the right thing for me to do. This is the right path. This is the right goal. This is the ultimate reality. So it's more more a form of conviction or clarity. Whereas devotion is more, we could say, a sense of affinity or emotion. Both are parts of the same relationship with the divine. But there is a slightly different focus to each of them. Okay? Does it answer your question?
Yes, yes. Hare Krishna. Got it.
Thank you. Hare Krishna. Any other questions?
Ah, Prabhuji, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Prabhuji, I am not a very, I have not read full Gita and full Ramayana, but I am attending the lecture and courses and I know a little bit of it. But I have never come across any type of the pandemic situation has been described there, either in Mahabharata or Ramayana, where the intervention of some supreme is being evident. There is a war, there is a conflict, there is everything is there. But the situation that presently we are having, this type of situation has been not been, in my knowledge, is not been written or I have not heard of that.
Yeah, good question. So, in the scriptures, have pandemics been described? Like two, three different things over here. First is the Vedic texts, they don't give an exhaustive account of history. They give a purposeful account of history. See, the purpose is to demonstrate, to describe events in the history of humanity where humanity rose to morality and spirituality. So, for example, times when the divine descended to the world, or times when those who were virtuous, they acted in special ways. So it's not a chronological history of all events. So in that sense, there could have been pandemics and they may not be described. So it's a selective description of history, and it's selected based on whatever serves a spiritual purpose. That's the first point to understand with respect to our scriptures. Second point is that it's also to be understood that diseases don't just occur in a vacuum. There's a famous doctor and you could say a medical scientist, René Dubois, who wrote Health in the 21st Century, The Future of an Illusion. So that book basically talks about that we may say that by scientific advancement, we removed the Black Plague, or we removed this, we almost eliminated smallpox, we eliminated. And he says, yes, that is only part of the story. He said that diseases arise because of certain socio-economic, socio-cultural situations. And when those socio-cultural situations change, the diseases also go away. So for example, the plague that was caused by the rats. So now, as human society moved towards a more urbanized setting, as even agriculture changed into agribusiness, so rats became less prevalent. And therefore, diseases coming by rats also became less likely. So the point is that diseases are, while the principle of disease is something which will always be there dogging humanity, but the specific diseases that we get are don't exist in a vacuum. They arise because of certain socio-cultural, socio-economic, socio-political factors. So you can say this particular pandemic, even if a pandemic like this had occurred in the past, now it is now that human society, at least from the perspective of recorded human history, has been far more connected than in the past. Because of that connectedness, this connectedness is because of trade, it is because of tourism, it is because of immigration. So even in the past, an epidemic had occurred. The Black Plague actually spread because there were not just traders, there were political conquests and so many people went across. That's how the plague spread, but it spread slowly because we were so interconnected. That's why the epidemic, wherever it started in Wuhan or wherever, from wherever it started, it just spread across the world so rapidly before we could come across anything. So the scale and the speed of the spread of this pandemic is a result of the socio-economic factors that we have in the world today. And when there are not similar socio-economic factors, there will be distress, there will be disasters, there will be diseases, but they'll be of different forms in different parts of the world. So we could say this is a product of the socio-economic situation. That's the second point. And third point would be that in we, certainly the pandemic that we have is huge. And for most of us, in our historic, in our memory, we have never seen anything like this.
Right.
But it's not like that in 1920s. There were issues. If you look at even last century, there were epidemics, but they didn't spread so fast across the world, and they didn't cause as much damage as they did because of our particular situation. So I would say that even human memory is not that sharp all the time. So apart from the scriptural records, if you look at other historical record also, how much of a historical record do we really have? Especially if we consider from the perspective of Indian history, for a long time, the Saraswati River was considered to be a mythological river. But it's only maybe a decade or so ago that American probes over the Thar desert, over the desert in Rajasthan, they found below the earth the remnants of a very extraordinarily large river. In fact, the riverbed was so large that there are evidences of houses being on the riverbeds. That means what happened was the riverbed was very large at one time. Then people normally live on the coast. Then as the river becomes smaller, then the people start coming closer. So what was the riverbed earlier becomes the riverbank. The people were living on the riverbank, and they lived for so long that the imprints, the remnants of their houses are still there on the ground over there. And then eventually the river dried up completely. So I would say in general, the state of archaeological research in India is quite underdeveloped. So from historical research, were there colossal health calamities like this? Who knows, in future research may tell us more about not just the empirical historical findings may come through archaeology, but who knows, we may find further documents. We know actually, it's, if we consider from the historical perspective, it's a significant miracle that the Vedic culture has survived despite nearly 1,000 years of aggression, vandalism, persecution, and so. In India, being a tropical country, leaves on which books were written, they themselves don't last. And on top of that, if there are aggressors trying to destroy the culture, destroy the wisdom, then they don't last. Then that will also happen. And even if they don't destroy, if they don't support financially, then maintaining them also will become difficult. So in spite of that, we have a significant body of scriptures still remaining. The commentators on scriptures, if you look at Madhvacharya or Jiva Goswami, they say that basically what we have now is barely 1-5% of the broad Vedic canon of scriptures. So many are lost. So there could be descriptions in those texts also. Okay?
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
One last question I'll ask, if somebody want to ask, and we close this session. If you want to comment anything, you can even share, you know. Yes.
So thank you very much for this opportunity to share spiritual wisdom with
sorry,
all of you.
Sorry, Prabhu. I wanted to ask one question.
Okay, sure. I'm just mentioning here, 1 minute, I have a couple of sites. There is GitaDaily.com, where I write every day on the Bhagavad Gita, a small 300-word article. There are over 4,000 articles there I've been writing for the last more than a decade. So you can subscribe for free over there. And there's a Gita Daily app also, where you can get it as an app on your phone. So there is also the Spiritual Scientist website, from which you can also get answers. There are almost many question answers over there. You can refer to that also if required. Thank you. Yes, you can ask the question, please.
Actually, beginning of this honeymoon period is over in bhakti. Like, we come to interact with the different kind of people. Like, we'd say, like, technically, Kanishka, Madhyama, Uddama. Like, so many like one we interact with their views, perceptions, lot of things like bombarding. Like in one of your lectures, I heard, oh, what is this God business up like that? So how to like, how I see people like you surviving or after all these. So you give practical experience from your life that which will help help to stay Krishna conscious forever.
Okay. Yeah.
You got my question, though I didn't put it this word properly.
Let me articulate the question and then you can tell me if I got it right. So basically, we may start practicing our spirituality in Krishna consciousness, but over time, we have different kinds of experiences, even while on the spiritual path. And we may face difficulties because of even other practitioners, because they are all different levels, different natures. And to persevere through all these obstacles and maintain our spirituality, how can we do that? Was that the question overall?
Yes, Prabhu.
Okay. So my understanding is that all of us gain strength from certain things. And we may have a spiritual purpose. We may come to we start practicing spirituality. So we have to find out what is it that makes us tick spiritually. For some of us, the primary fuel on our spiritual journey may be intellectual. We may like the wisdom. We may like the philosophy and we get stimulated by that. For some of us, it may be more cultural. Cultural means we like to go to a temple. We like to see the deities. We like to hear kirtans. We like to do worship. We like to go to holy places. For some of us, it may be more relational. Relational means that, I come here and I meet good people. They're well-behaved. They're virtuous. They're caring. And I want to be with these people. If ever I want to be counted with anyone, I want to be counted with these people and not with others. So, also, like this, I'm just giving three. There could be more also. But broadly speaking, there are certain things like these which are the primary spurs. They are the primary fuel on the spiritual path, our spiritual journey. So once we understand this, then the next step is to make sure that that fuel keeps coming to us. So if we consider, say, now I mentioned three things. So, or a fourth thing, you could be more of emotional or psychological. We are just very disturbed by life, and meditation or prayer, they just make us feel very calm and serene and peaceful. And that's what we like. We feel good when we come to a temple, we come to a spiritual place. So it's something related to relational, but it's more of emotional, psychological. So if you consider these to be four, imagine this to be like a circle or a square. Now at the center of this square is the ultimate reality, is Krishna. And we have all these paths. There could be intellectual path, there could be a social relational path, there could be a cultural path, there could be a emotional mental path. Now whichever way we come to Krishna, sometimes what happens for us is that particular method for approaching Krishna becomes our substitute for Krishna. What I mean is that, I come to Krishna because, see, those devoted to Krishna, the devotees are such nice people. And then we start taking shelter of the devotees and the devotees' nice behavior instead of Krishna. Or we may start taking shelter of the culture in the temple instead of Krishna. Now the culture, the association, or the philosophy, all these are meant to help us take shelter of Krishna. And they will help us definitely. But sometimes what is meant to be a means becomes the end. And when that happens, that's where we become situated on. In the Bible, it is said the world is like a bridge. Don't make your home on the bridge. Cross over the bridge. So for all of us, we need to make sure that this is not becoming an alternative shelter. This is a bridge. Now, by bridge, I don't mean it's utilitarian, it has to be given up, but that. So if my primary purpose in associating with devotees is, oh, because devotees are such nice people. But then we will find some simple devotees may not behave so nicely. Now, there could be various reasons for that. It could be because of, those devotees have their own conditionings. Sometimes we have certain conditionings because of which we rub them wrongly. Whatever it is, we will never have a utopia in this world. So if we think, oh, I am with devotees because they behave so nicely, and then they don't behave so well, say, what am I doing being here? Well, I am here not just to be with nice people. I am here to be with Krishna. And of course, we need a supportive social environment, and we may have to find the right supportive social environment. Maybe these people I can't get along. I mean, the devotee community is also very large. I can't get along with these devotees. That doesn't mean they are bad or I am bad. It just means that we are not so compatible. So let me find those devotees who are like-minded, and let me take their shelter. So similarly, if our focus is more intellectual and we hear stimulating wisdom and that inspires us, but sometimes we find that we have questions and those questions just don't get answers. And we start getting annoyed. What's happening? And we ask questions and people say, why are you so over hyper analytical? Just be devotional. And that vexes us even more. So then if our intellectual side is becoming our substitute to our spiritual side, instead of being a path to the spiritual side, then we need to know that I'm here not just to get intellectual stimulating stuff. Yes, I want all this intellectual stimulation to eventually help me develop a spiritual connection. And for that spiritual connection, what do I need? I need to move onward. So of course, I may still need intellectual stimulation. And then I may have to again find those sources where I can get that intellectual stimulation. That maybe some kind of classes, some kind of writing, some kind of communicating style, I may not be able to gel with it. And there are others I might gel with. So I have to find that. So we also need to be resourceful to find what it takes for us to keep moving in our spiritual life. See, our spiritual growth is our responsibility. It is nobody else's responsibility. It is not the devotee community's responsibility. It is not any spiritual organization's responsibility. It is not even our spiritual teacher's responsibility. It is our responsibility. They all can help us. So I'll conclude this answer that various things are resources for our spiritual growth. When we start thinking of them as the sources of our spirituality, then that's where the problem comes. They are not sources, nor are they destinations. They are resources. Of course, they are valuable resources. They may be even indispensable resources, but they are still resources. So to find out what is it that gives you strength, and then evaluate how are you using that or accessing that to keep moving toward Krishna. And then find out how you can keep gaining access to that, keep gaining access or keep connecting with that so that you can keep connecting with Krishna. That's how we can persevere in our spiritual journey. Okay?
So thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Sri Ramchandra Bhagavan ki. Jai Shri Prabhupada ki.
Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna. Thank you.